Welcome everyone to this evening's event, which is part of the Tavistock Centenary Celebrations. My name's Helen Shaw and I am your chair for the night. I work at the Tavistock and Portman NHS Foundation Trust in the Department of Education, managing a range of postgraduate trainings, and I'm also a systems psychodynamic trained organisational consultant and coach. We're going to be assisted tonight. You'll see the communications slide you might see up there by Mike Smith, the Trust's head of communications, who's dealing with some of the technicalities that will become apparent to you as we go through the evening. I hope this evening will prove to be thought-provoking and enjoyable as we explore leadership and followership with two people at the heart of their professions. Mick Doran will be in conversation with Lydia Hartland-Rowe about experiences of leading and following from the heart of the orchestra and from other aspects of working life as a professional musician. Together, they will explore the parallels between leading and following in music settings and leading and following in any environment. So some introductions. My colleague Lydia Hartland-Rowe is Workforce Wellbeing Lead at the Trust and a psychoanalytic child psychotherapist. She's been an active clinician and educator at the Tavistock and elsewhere since 2000. She is also currently director of one of our four annual group relations conferences. Mick Doran, who you see up there on the screen, is Principal Percussionist of the English National Opera Orchestra, a regular on radio and TV. He also enjoys a busy freelance career with the UK's premier orchestras, opera and ballet companies, as well as working on many top film scores, West End musicals, and playing contemporary music and jazz. As a professor at Trinity Laban Conservatoire of Music, he enjoys passing on his experiences to a new generation of players. So before I hand over to Lydia to give some introductory remarks, a brief outline of the evening. Lydia will set the scene with a short presentation that will then be followed by a conversation illustrated with some music between Lydia and Mick. We will then have a very short break, comfort break, and then we'll open both the chat and the floor for contributions and reflections on what you've heard. It will be on a strictly raise your hand basis, and we do recognise that this is a large meeting and it means some of you may be disappointed and ask you to bear with us. I will then invite Lydia and Mick to share any final reflections before we close at 9 o'clock. So, Lydia, over to you.
Okay, thanks, Helen. So the first thing we're going to do is actually do what this is ultimately all about, which is we're going to listen to some music. So I'm going to ask Mike to play the first clip for us. There's so much going on, and you see something just sort of growing and starting. And when the shot goes up and you see the orchestra there, there's this wonderful sight of all these people doing something collective and extraordinary. And you see the bass players, which is very important. So in this first section, I just want to give some background to the conversation that we're going to have and to set the stage for the focus. So this particular conversation is mostly about Western classical music, although Mick will also be talking about experiences in the wider musical world, including jazz. But the background is the orchestra and the connections between the work of the orchestral musician as they lead and follow both in and out of the rehearsal room and concert hall, and how this connects with wider organizational life. Now, part of the background to this event is my own experience. The piece of music that we've just listened to is the opening of Mahler's First Symphony. It was the first piece I ever played in as an orchestral bass player. There've been musicians in the family in previous generations, and music lessons and the joy not of practicing had been part of my life off and on since I was a little girl, but nothing had really stuck. But at 16, I could see that my viola playing sister in the local youth orchestra was having fun and meeting boys. And they needed bass players, and the bass and I got on well. Now, Mahler 1 is one of the blessedly rare pieces where the plaintive, humorous, or grotesque is usually behind the need for a double bass solo. But it also has one of the easiest first 50 bars for at least some of the bass section, because it's just an open A that goes on for bar after bar after bar. So you can be in it without really doing very much at all. So there I was, and I still remember just that there was nothing like that first experience of being inside something, and as a bass player sitting up high from a position where I could also watch and listen as well as play, with less to do than some of the other sections of the orchestra. So throughout the rest of my teens, I thought the best possible thing to do in life would be to play in an orchestra, that is to get paid for doing something so extraordinary. And I think that as well as the music and being part of a safe adolescent group, I also found something in the complex need for collaboration, for following, and for getting on with different people in and outside of the rehearsal room. Well, at music college, where I met Mick quite a few years ago, all of that intensified with exposure to remarkable repertoire, remarkable players, some remarkable teachers, and one or two remarkable conductors. And also exposure to the reality of other key aspects of what was part of the world of a working musician: uncertainty, the need for gaining and sustaining authority over the instrument, the need to tolerate the authority of others, the work of playing the Messiah, not for the first exciting time, but for the 10th, and the world of work outside the rehearsal room and concert hall, the ongoing need to be able to collaborate, to network, to get along with people, to be organized, to not be a prima donna, but part of a shared endeavor, whether playing together and using bowings you don't agree with, or knowing that it's your turn to buy the round. Well, some of the compromises were what I think I was learning would be the job: following the leadership of others, even when I disagreed, accepting that others had both the talent of hard work and a greater ability to play than I did, recognizing that the freelance world would mean tolerating a huge level of uncertainty, and that the rare permanent orchestral job only came through a successful audition on the day, as well as a trial. So needing to be able to play and perform, but also to be part of a group. some of the things I learned, I think, were more about the particular culture of the bass player world, getting used to a particular kind of humor, often rougher than I was comfortable with, a lot of drink, a lot of teasing, and an unspoken rule that while playing great and indifferent music felt good and was important, deep conversation about that wasn't so important. My experience of the opportunity to learn to become a musician certainly gave me the skill to do a little bit of freelance work in the years after leaving college and the capacity to teach and to coach youth orchestra double bass sections for more years than that. But what it also exposed me to was the reality of the work of a professional orchestral musician. And some of what I sensed was needed to succeed in that work beyond a relationship to the instrument and the music. A world of complex relationships, the capacity to manage leading and following in good heart, and the need for a down-to-earth and straightforward relationship to music as a job, whatever else it might be and offer, like any job. Now, I didn't take that path and have ended up here instead, but all of this is part of the background to this event. It's always seemed really important to me to find ways to think about the making of music beyond the things that more often interest psychoanalytic writers. That is, its relationship usually to the early dyad, to the psychic function and meaning of music, the meaning of its emotional impact. The focus in that work is also usually on the most visible individuals in a musical context. So the composer, the soloist, the singer, the conductor, or maybe a small chamber ensemble where everyone is seen and every part can be tracked. Now, these are all, of course, important and they're worthy of interest, but I think there's something also that's really crucial about looking at and thinking about the lives and working realities of a wider, more diverse group and their craft and expertise. So there's another little bit of background to this particular theme of leading and following, even when it hurts. As some of you will know, one of the most powerful learning experiences that we offer here at the Tavistock are group relations events. And they're an opportunity for a group of people to learn what kind of processes, conscious and unconscious, go on in groups and organizations all the time by pausing for a number of days and forming what we call a temporary organization. And the work of that organization is to work together to look closely at what's going on in that group and make some parallels to what goes on elsewhere. As a trainee child psychotherapist, I did my first group relations conference in 1999. And for the first time, I understood something about the complexity of the relationships to authority that I'd really struggled with as a music student learning to play in an orchestral bass section. That responsibility to completely manage and balance my authority over my instrument, can I play the part as well as I possibly can, and the parallel responsibility to be ready to accept and follow the authority of others. So the section leader and his infuriating bowings, the conductor and their idiosyncratic beat or show-off tempo, the principal cellist having the nerve to tell the bass section that they were too loud. For the first time in a group relations conference, I had a glimpse of the unconscious undercurrents that a working group of orchestral musicians might have to manage. And my appreciation of friends and colleagues who'd succeeded in the profession, whether as freelancers or members of an orchestra, increased. There are also links that we can learn from when we start to hear from Mick in terms of organizational life. So the work that an orchestra does has an emotional impact. And actually all workplaces have an emotional impact, whatever their output. Put crudely, it's probably our relationships with each other and with the task that we share that generate most feeling, whether it's known about and acknowledged or not. Now, the orchestra has often been used as a metaphor or an example to draw on in leadership literature and as a focus for study. There's less focus on another really crucial aspect of musical life, which is followership. And more crucially, the relationship between the two that generates something new. And that's where I think some really helpful parallels can be drawn. Just at the moment, there is something about the emotional climate of an NHS organization or a social care organization that feels particularly challenging. How work feels to us matters more than ever, because we're also struggling with how much the public sector matters in the wider social and political picture. Depending on where we are in what kind of public sector organization, most of us constantly face the need to collaborate with an interpretation of the welfare state that we don't agree with, let alone the decisions that are having to be made at the moment to do things in the interests of the patient, the team, or the organization that are necessary to try and ensure survival, but mean taking action that will also hurt, and where there's also the very painful risk that it might not be possible to heal or to cure or to save anyway. Now, one aspect of this event that Mick and I haven't been able to include is an element of observation. At a more optimistic time in the late autumn, the plan had been for me to do some observations of the ENO orchestra rehearsing to make another link between a well-established practice at the Tavistock of observing infants, children, and organizations. With the current lockdown, this wasn't possible, but it made me think about other experiences I've had of observing an orchestral environment, specifically some observations I did a few years ago at a primary school in Leeds who were implementing the El Sistema approach. Now, this is not a model of music education, but a model for social action. It's the model is that children are exposed to a great deal of shared group music making, either in a school or a community setting. And it's aimed at developing leadership capacities in children by encouraging group music making in the form of orchestral teaching. And all teaching happens in groups. So the group and how it's related to is as important as any individual and their abilities, talents, or capacities for work. Now, in the primary school that I observed in a quite fairly deprived area of Leeds, many different languages spoken, quite a few children on, you know, sort of free school meals, those sorts of measures. And in more than one observation, I was struck by how clearly the group, the instruments, and the sound being made provided a kind of holding and strength that was more than the individuals in the ensemble. I was really taken with one very distracted, chaotic, and distressed little boy who was playing the double bass, as it happened, who was mostly not able to focus or join in, but he was still part of the whole. And even when he only managed to play once or twice at the same time as everybody else, he was following and connected. He had some agency over his body and the instrument, and he was part of something better and bigger than himself. I'm not sure about better than himself, but bigger than himself. What was moving in observing these children was not how well they played or didn't, or what they sounded like, but their connection to each other. The looking and listening, especially when it clearly came for some as a huge achievement. One of the things I really enjoyed seeing most was the casual way they related to the instruments. They were equipment, nothing more, nothing less, with which they were as familiar because of this really repeated exposure as with other pieces of school equipment. They weren't precious or rarefied. They were just tools for the task of doing something together. So whatever the El Sistema model is and where it's ended up, and there's a bigger discussion about that, its core purpose related to leadership in the context of changing an unjust society. And of course, with COVID, the inequities of society have been re-exposed. And there's also been an explicit and shameful lack of acknowledgement in this country of how much music and musicians matter to society, with the profession both hard hit by the impact of lockdowns on earning and living, and not represented in any significant way in financial recognition of what's been lost. So for all of these reasons, it feels like a rare opportunity to talk to someone who lives and works in the heart of the orchestra, in the heart of the profession, and as the leader of a section that keeps the pulse of the orchestra going as it follows the score, the conductor, and each other. So what will happen next is a conversation with Mick, guided by 9 questions that we thought would open some of this up. Actually, it might be fewer than 9 now. We've combined a few, but a number of questions that we thought would open up some of this and help to explore leading, following, and working in a complex environment. Expect to hear about what things feel like, including the way that humor seems to be such a part of life in orchestral environments. I think you're really going to enjoy this, hopefully, as much as I am. So I will go to our first question for you, Mick. So when we were at college, I was at one of a very few young women playing the double bass. That's changed, but at that time there were very, very few of us. This is in the early 80s. And we were also a very white student population, although I think that in terms of class, the success of state school music education in this country in the 60s and 70s probably meant that there was more diversity and different routes that people came through to get to the profession. So in your experience, where's the music profession now? And just to say, you know, you're in this virtual building at the Tavistock where we ourselves are facing enormous challenges in the area of equality and diversity.
Well, first of all, good evening, everybody. It's really a great honour to be invited to take part in this. So thank you to the Tavistock and Portman. It's a great thing to be able to do. Lydia, I totally agree with what you said about the opportunities available to our sort of generation growing up in the 60s and 70s. I gained a place at the Royal Academy of Music on the back of free or cheap instrumental tuition. A Saturday morning music school that was run by the City Council, where I received further tuition and experience playing in bands and orchestras, and a county youth orchestra system that enabled me to go on to a slightly higher level and experience a wide variety of Western classical music at really low cost. And then when I did get to the Academy, I also received a grant for attending college and some further assistance, even for living expenses, which I think were based on a means test. But without any of that, I would never have got as far as the Royal Academy of Music. And I consider myself hugely lucky. I now teach at Trinity Laban Conservatoire of Music and Dance, and I see my students coming from a much narrower demographic, for sure. I mean, certainly in terms of class. I see far more students around Trinity from a BAME background than I experienced when I was a student, and yet I see fewer of them translating that into working in symphony, opera, and ballet orchestras. So my fear is that music teaching in school has been eroded to such an extent that people just aren't aware of the musical choices that they could have, or the joy that we've experienced of learning an instrument and participating in ensembles. It's become financially impossible for many people to commit to those sort of studies. And I genuinely believe that people have had their eyes opened about the viability of a career in music when they find out how much it costs in financial terms, but also in personal commitment. I mean, if you think about £40,000 worth of debt and the thousands and thousands of hours of practice that a music student puts in, it doesn't feel like a great platform on which you're going to base a career, which, as you said earlier, has a huge amount of uncertainty, constant judgment, criticism, irregular work, antisocial hours, touring away from home and families, no real career path in many cases, and very unlikely to get a pension of any substance. And all that in exchange for a freelance existence, or if you're very, very lucky, like me, a job that would earn a tutti, which is a sort of one of the violinists, the many violinists in the orchestra, a salary of somewhere around £35,000 per year in London. It's not all bad though. There are some positives. Unlike the male-dominated orchestras of the past, and you referenced when you arrived at the Academy being one of very few female bass students. I mean, you've got to bear in mind that it's not that long ago that the Vienna Philharmonic used to insist on a male-only orchestra, other than a lady harpist. Nowadays, the balance for gender equality is hugely improved. I can only speak for my own orchestra, the English National Opera Orchestra, where we have an almost 50-50 split male and female. And one positive thing to bear in mind is that thanks to the collective bargaining that happens between the musicians' union and musical institutions, within those institutions, if someone's doing the same job as someone else in that orchestra, they will get paid exactly the same without question of gender at all. There is a fixed rate and that's adhered to. I'm very pleased and proud that E&O is a real beacon for equality generally, because we have existing programs that reach out to singers, players, directors, technicians, but most importantly, perhaps, audiences, young and old, from a massively diverse range of backgrounds. I suppose, having got over all that, you've then got to get a job, and it is a job. So perhaps I could talk a little bit about the audition process, and people will see what they need to guide themselves through the process of a young musician.
Yeah, I mean, I think that comes under the sort of leadership outside the gig. You were going to talk a bit about what that is, you know, the bit.
Yeah.
Not about the thing. Yeah.
Well, just so people know, to get a job, the normal route is to having gone through music college or perhaps university, you don't need that piece of paper. You come out usually with a degree, but you don't need that piece of paper, because when you go for an audition, all you're going to be judged on is your capability as a player. And the classical music business is still very much has to be a meritocracy. More and more auditions are being held behind screens. But if you're successful in the first round, you might be passed through to a second round or directly to trial. Now, a trial is when you're invited to work for a period of time with the orchestra in the position you've applied for. Positions don't tend to become, you don't tend to apply for a job before the person has left their chair. You tend to go in for a couple of weeks, you play a few programs, and it's an opportunity for the people around you to see how your playing stands up under the scrutiny of your colleagues and conductors, and the general stress and pressure of live performance. And because several other people will have also been put through to trial, it means that it can become a very slow process, getting to the point of actually choosing a successful candidate. So it's not unusual for a trial period to last 2, 3, or even more years. It can even happen that if the panel don't consider any of the candidates good enough, the players on trial are released and the whole process starts again. You have to have incredible personal strength to be able to survive that sort of thing. Then when, if you've been appointed, you start working with the orchestra on a probationary period, which is usually 9 months or a year. Now, under that system, that's rarely invoked. Sometimes very experienced players with a great reputation will be pushed straight through to the trial phase without an audition. And so that's how you end up getting to the appointment. There are great advantages to this system, because when it works, you usually find the right person best suited to that particular job. And they tend to give the orchestra long and loyal service. In other countries, kind of win the job on a single day of auditions and are appointed immediately on a probationary period. The problem with that is that quite often they don't live up to the promise they showed in the audition. And so after a year, they're let go and the whole process starts again. And it seems a very strange system, but no one's found a better way of doing it. Neither are perfect. And when they work against the musician, it's then that it causes sort of intolerable stress and strain. And it can have real serious effects on people's mental health. I had a friend who found himself on trial with a variety of top-ranking orchestras constantly for 13 years. And he was an absolutely brilliant player, and he never quite ticked the boxes that the people were looking for. And unfortunately, he became hugely dependent on alcohol. He broke down. He lost everything he loved, his wife, his home, and cruelest of all, perhaps, given these circumstances, all his work. And I suppose the final thing about this is that once you're in, you can never rest on your laurels. The old adage of you're only as good as your last gig is really true. So that brings its own stress. Can you ever relax? People find a way, but it can be extremely telling on people's stamina, mentally, physically, and the way they can motivate themselves.
I mean, it's really interesting, the kind of how do you work out whether you're looking for an individual through just an audition, but then you don't know how they'll be in the group, Or do you put people through something where you learn a lot about how they manage in a group, but then you expose them to even more uncertainty? So it's a real challenge.
Yeah.
So Mick, I think the next question is one that you're going to speak to with quite a few examples. Is that we're moving into the section where you've got quite a few clips.
I think we've got a question about leadership and teamwork as we build up. Yeah.
Okay. So this is the one about leadership outside the gig. Is
that's
that the one?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, I jumped ahead.
That's all right.
Okay.
Leadership outside the gig. I thought the easiest way to deal with this was to give you a couple of practical examples, because let's talk about a freelance performance first and how it comes about and how things change. So there's a real complex web of leadership and teamwork and as you build up to something like that. So the first thing that happens is you get a phone call. In fact, actually, before I say that, let's create an imaginary colleague who's a violinist. Let's call her Lydia. Okay, let's call her Lydia. So Lydia is a violinist, and she gets a call from the fixer. Fixer is somebody who works for a promoter, and or he could be promoting the thing himself. And he phones them up and says, "Will you do a gig at the Albert Hall in 2 weeks' time?" So Lydia says, yes, I'll put it in my diary. And then that's it. 2 weeks later, she needs to arrive at the venue in time, get warmed up and be ready for the rehearsal. Now, of course, in the meantime, Lydia has been working elsewhere, probably doing other gigs, and would have put in hours of practice for personal practice. But essentially, that's what she has to do for that one engagement. As a percussionist and one who's quite often, luckily, called upon to be a principal of a section, the process becomes somewhat more involved. So I get the same phone call from the fixer, and of course I say yes, and thank you very much. The next thing is I've got to find out what we're going to play, and so that probably involves a conversation with the guy running the library. From there I know what the music is, and I can work out what equipment we need. And also, if I've been asked to employ a section of percussionists, the sort of player I'm going to be looking for. But first, I might have to speak to the conductor, or if appropriate, a composer, just to find out some details about interpretation or what they're really looking for. From then, I go onto the phase where I select players for my section. And this is a bit like being a football manager. If you book a team of goalkeepers, then you know you're not going to score. Equally, if you've got 11 centre forwards, you're going to leak at the back. So it's really important to get the right person for the right job, and to find a real balance in your section. And so you build up through your experience a kind of list of people you know and trust who will deliver on the day. You then have to organise the equipment. Now, that means getting together the stuff that you either own or you hire from a company. And so there's a sort of things to deal with there. And then possibly the most important phone call is to the truck driver. They get various labels, say shifters or stage managers. But basically the guy is going to get the equipment there. And the tone of the conversation you're going to have with him, coming from usually a very workmanlike background, is going to be totally different to the conversation you have with the conductor or composer who's probably had a university education. And although I don't want to stereotype people, I'm afraid that it's a fairly accurate description of what happens. So you have to be one thing for one person and another thing for another. And then you arrange yourself to be there at the right time. You get onto the stage, set it all up, and then 15 minutes before the rehearsal, go and have a cup of tea. And then as you walk on to the stage a minute or two before the rehearsal actually starts, Lydia is sitting there in her chair at the back, and she turns around and says, "You're cutting it a bit fine, aren't you?" So after all that, no one really gets it. And she could be the same person who, when you walk into the pub an hour after the gig, having packed everything up, made sure things are going to be returned to the right place at the right time, turns to you and says, wow, you've taken your time. Now, I find that a hugely exhilarating process to deal with because of all the different characters and the knowledge that at the end of the whole process, you're going to try and deliver a successful performance. And so you become a bit of a chameleon because from the moment you pick up the phone to the fixer, you're the employee. And then you become the leader. Then the leader becomes collaborator. The collaborator becomes the leader again. And then you become the employer. Then you become a collaborator again. And then when you're on the stage doing the gig, you're a follower, leader, and team member simultaneously. Then you become a leader again to make sure that you're right there with your guys, you deliver. And then when it's all said and done, you become the beer buyer. Contracted orchestras have management systems in place that have developed and expanded over the years. So there's no doubt that the demands of orchestral management, whether external, coming from within or without, have grown. And so we've seen a small army of people who now work in orchestral management, and it's growing, ever growing. I think I'm right to say that when I did my first date with the Royal Philharmonic, their management team probably consisted of about 6 or 7 people. And that's from chief exec right down to the stage manager. And I checked on their website, now it's 26. The Scottish Chamber Orchestra hosts a playing member of 31 and supports an administration of 24. So there's a whole new perception on what kind of leadership is needed there. It's fair to say it's a real bugbear of playing musicians that there is, there seems to be a job creation scheme for the guys who work in the office. And you can understand that people get upset because orchestral musicians' pay has been eroded over the years, in real terms at least. And the very people who are the product are getting cut, while the support team seems to expand and take up an increasing amount of the budget. And the reason I mention this is because some of the bigger orchestras are self-governing. In other words, they lead themselves from within. So when you join one of those orchestras, effectively you become a shareholder in Orchestra PLC and a part of a team that appoint the management and therefore hopefully the correct leaders. The board will consist of a combination of chosen figures from the world of the arts and business, as well as a panel elected from the body of the players. Now, that makes it really interesting because sometimes that works extremely well and sometimes it doesn't work at all. And it's so dependent on the personalities that are involved because it's really difficult if you're sitting next to someone playing a symphony, making art with someone at 11 o'clock, and then at 11:30 in the coffee break, find yourself having discussions about the possible sacking of a player or the revoking of a conductor's contract or something like that. So I have to say, it's never been an atmosphere that I've looked at with any relish. An old pro once warned me about a particular orchestra, no names, saying that when you went in there, you needed to be careful because if someone patted you on the back, they weren't necessarily congratulating you. They were just finding the softest place they could stick the dagger. In situations like that, the lines between leadership, followership, teamwork, and selfishness become incredibly blurred. And the jobs I've been lucky enough to hold have always been full-time positions where the players are the players and the managers are the managers. And everybody's boundaries, whether it's as a leader or a follower, are clearly defined. And for that to work, you've got to have mutual respect, or at least that you aspire for. And you hope that the clarity of those definitions improve the decision-making for everyone as a whole.
I mean, it's really interesting, Mick, and I'm sure it will come up in the discussion, the number of sort of parallels, you know, an NHS that saw a sort of boom in management as a sort of layer in previous decades and people who were clinicians and managers, and there's lots of parallels, really interesting. So next question, which is the one where you've got lots of clips, which is really about sort of, you know, where does leadership come in relation to the score and the music and, you know, sort of who is leading And you know, what role does the conductor have? You know, where does leadership sort of stem from? And I guess probably most people, if you asked who led in an orchestra, they would think it was the conductor, possibly. So over to you for quite a lot of interesting material in that area.
Yeah, this is quite a big subject. I mean, we're blurring two questions here.
Yeah.
Let's deal with the score first. Because that is, I find, a fascinating subject. Gustav Mahler wrote that everything is written in the score except the really important things. And I think it's wrong to say, actually, that an orchestra is led by the score. The whole event is. I don't think it matters if you're doing a concert of Beethoven or a Puccini opera. The reason everybody's there is because once upon a time, a genius put pen to paper and wrote that masterpiece. And we've learned as a society that the brilliance of that particular piece of art needs to be experienced. And so we think it's appropriate to put in a system that we can celebrate it. Now, it's easier with visual arts because we just build galleries, we hang them, and we can invite people in to look at them. But with music, there's got to be a huge amount of coordination to pull people together to perform and listen, most importantly, and experience it. So you either do a live gig or the alternative is to record it. And it could be that even a straightforward, in inverted commas, performance of Beethoven's Seventh Symphony, or if you're doing a wildly contemporary interpretation of Madame Butterfly that features people clad in leather bondage gear swinging from the ceiling, and I should say, working at ENO, we haven't done that. Well, not yet, anyway. But the starting point, whatever it is always the score, because without that, there's nothing. A couple of years ago, I was really flattered and surprised, actually, to be invited to appear on a Radio 4 programme called Tales from the Stave, where musicians and musicologists are invited to look over the original manuscript score of certain pieces of music. And the program I was involved in was to do with Haydn's 103rd Symphony, which is nicknamed the drum roll. And the panel met at the British Museum, where we were taken into a small room, and the score was brought out by a man wearing white gloves and lovingly placed on a green velvet table. And we were allowed to see the music as written by the hand of Haydn in 1795. Now, I hadn't anticipated how moving I would find the experience. Looking at the squiggles and scribblings of a man who obviously in places was working under severe time pressure, sometimes the writing was unclear and the notes were crossed out because he was using pen, not pencil, and there were little shortcuts and abbreviations, and it was a hugely personal experience. And I realized that for all his genius, he was still just a working musician, just the same as me. I mean, except I haven't got the genius bit, I know, but you know, it was very touching. And I think most musicians will tell you that it's a joy to have the luxury of time to study the score. And I suppose in a way that's what conductors are paid for. But whatever your walk of life within the music business, at some point you will always have to return to the original written material. A little anecdote. In 2000, I spent a couple of weeks on tour with Camerata Ireland and their music director, Barry Douglas. Anyone who doesn't know Barry, he's a phenomenal concert pianist who won the Tchaikovsky competition, and that put him up in the highest echelons of the music world. And I wasn't a player on that tour, I was the orchestra manager. And it was a fascinating insight to me from the other side. He and I had a meeting every couple of times a day. And invariably, one of them would be on an aeroplane because every day we flew to another part of South America to do a concert. And whenever I went up to sit next to Barry, he would put down the score. It'd be one of the scores he'd be conducting that night. And he explained that it was the only chance he got to try and get inside the composer's mind. Because the rest of his day, he was being a soloist, a conductor, a PR guru, a chief executive, you know, everything. But it suddenly occurred to me, the simple fact was that the only reason I was on that aeroplane with him was to go and perform the score he was learning. This whole infrastructure just came from those notes that had been written years before. So it's quite simple, really. Everybody and everything follows the score. So the greatest leaders in this massive web are the creators, the Bach, Mozart, Beethoven, all those guys, contemporary composers now. So wherever they lead, we merely follow. So the other part of your question, and this is the big bit, is I think you said who's really leading. So I think that's probably, you know, do you need a conductor is probably the question that most musicians get asked the most. Do you really need a conductor? And I think there's as many answers to that as there are people who aspire to conduct. We don't have a lot of time to go into the full, some call it dark art of conducting. But I think it's important that we look at a few examples. Now, before we do, I'd like to play something which I hope will show how musicians have to react to a conductor's beat. Now, you have to bear with me because we had a few technical issues before we came online. So I'm going to try and share my screen and find the right thing. And I found it. Brilliant. So I hope everyone can see a black screen. Lydia, can you give me a thumbs up? Yeah, we're good? Right, okay. So I must thank my wife, Sophie, who is a professional flautist with the BBC Concert Orchestra, for helping me out assembling this little clip. To explain, I didn't tell her what we were going to do. I just explained that we needed a simple tune that we could use to give examples. And just a few minutes before we recorded this, I told her we'd do the first 9 notes of the Blue Danube Waltz. So here's the tune, exactly as Sophie played it, just off the cuff, and she'd hardly had time to warm up or anything. So here we go. So I hope everyone could hear that. You probably all know the tune, so that's good. The next thing I did was bring myself into the equation, and with the aid of a chopstick, because that was all we had in our kitchen at the time, I started to beat, and I asked Sophie to play as tight to my beat as she possibly could. So this is, dare I say, quite regimental band playing, that you go really close on the beat, and hopefully any time lag you'll be able to work out exactly what Sophie's doing. So let's see what happened. So there you see she's playing very much in time with what I'm directing her, but that's really just timekeeping. The next thing I asked her to do was something which is very hard to replicate, and quite hard to explain. But I asked her to assume the position of the section leader of the flute section, and therefore quite probably the leader of the woodwind section that sits within the bigger context of the orchestra. Because what often happens is you have to allow for the information that comes through the conductor's beat to register with 80, sometimes more people. And so there is inevitably a slight delay, and the musicians have a second sense about how to wait and breathe. Even if they're not a wind player, they breathe and come together on the downbeat, except it's always after the beat by a split second. When I first joined ENO, I couldn't understand how someone could go like that, and that would be the amount of time. Let's see how brilliantly Sophie replicates it. I hope that's sort of clear. It's a hard concept to get hold of. The next example is what's he doing? It could be what's she doing. It's basically when you've got a conductor who is neither, he's not giving and not really taking either. And so I'm, in this clip, trying to show that I'm leading, but I'm not paying any attention to anything else that's going on. And as brilliant a musician as Sophie is, I think you see that she kind of struggles to sort of go with me and that sort of thing. So here we go. And now the final example is where I just took a moment to exchange the ideas with Sophie. And it became obvious that what really needed to happen to get the phrase to come out was there had to be an interchange of who was leading. And so the first four notes I gave to her. And that was her moment to lead me. And then the following bit, which is the umpah-pah bit, was mine, because then I had to get everybody in this imaginary orchestra to come with me. Just watch the interplay between me beating and following her and then trying to exchange the power. So hopefully, I mean, they are fine differences, but that's what orchestral musicians deal with all the time. And then just for a bit of fun, we did this. And this is self-explanatory. This is my willing volunteer, my wife, Sophie, who has been so brilliant at doing this for me. We're now going to do an experiment, and I'm going to ask her to play something that she's not expecting to play, but I know that she's got in her head, which is the flute solo for the hornpipe from the Fantasia on British Sea Songs that you always hear on the last night of the proms. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to beat, might be 1, 2, or 4, okay. And you've got to react accordingly, no matter how ridiculous it sounds, okay. And just see how quick a musician's reaction is to what a conductor can lay down.
Okay, great. I'll try.
Thank you. Don't mess up. Okay. Actually, I think, I'm not sure if Sophie's on the call, but it's the nearest going to get to a concert tonight. So a big round of applause to Sophie, I think. So hopefully that just gives you an idea of how we have to react and the different things that are involved in dealing with a way a conductor communicates and either leads or doesn't. And I'd like to now talk about a few of the different styles of conductor and illustrate them with some films. So first of all, there are wreckers. Now, sometimes people literally buy an orchestra for a day so that they can stand in front of them, wave their arms in the pursuit of glory and aggrandizement. Sometimes they are famous musicians who perhaps have had a distinguished career in other areas of music, a concert soloist or a chamber musician, and they feel that they want to express themselves differently, or sometimes that their particular skills are waning and they are desperate to stay in the music business. They stand in front of orchestras, technically incompetent, often inspirationally devoid, and unfortunately, quite often are utterly charmless. They are hugely reliant on the orchestra to get them through the performance without a major catastrophe. In many ways, these are the best conductors to work for because they give us the best and funniest stories, But I'm afraid at the time it's not funny. It's as petrifying as it can be, because it's your reputation as a player that's on the line, because you seldom hear a conductor's mistakes. And there's another layer, a middle group of conductors who are the ones you tend to spend most of your professional career working with. They're usually quite highly educated, articulate, sensitive, informed musicians who genuinely try to serve the score and usually respect the musicians that they have been put up in front of, because they understand that it's a symbiotic relationship. If we don't play, there's no noise. But if they don't bring something to the party, then it makes it very, very bland. And then the final group are an elite. And this is a very hard thing to explain, because somehow this group of conductors managed to create an amazing aura around them that commands respect, affection, sometimes love from musicians, and engenders a real feeling of trust and leadership to the extent that players will follow them into any musical battle. It's usually, to get to that point, it's usually borne out in the rehearsal process, where it's become so glaringly obvious that the conductor understands, truly understands the music, and he's devoured the score, and he's inside the composer's head, and then the musicians can relax. These conductors are the ones that usually trust the players, because they know the struggle that the player would have had to get to the point of being in the orchestra to even play that piece. And they also know that the best way to ignite any orchestra is to allow a musician a long lead, to give them the opportunity to show their artistry and not be a sort of bandsman like I was in that first clip, but coax, entice, and sometimes bash it out of the players, just to get that different experience. Now, for now, we're going to forget about the duff conductors and talk about the ones who at worst are highly competent. Let's look at some styles and the way that they communicate, and we'll talk about the way that they go between leading and following. Now, the first clip that we're going to play, and I hope Mike is ready there, is a conductor called Sir Adrian Bolt, who died in the early 70s. He was taught by a very famous conductor from the late 19th century called Artur Nikisch. And you'll notice that he has a very long baton, which moves very fluently through the first two fingers and thumb of his hand. He keeps it high so that you as the player are forced to look into his eyes. His left hand is generally static, apart from to coax a little thing here and there. But the big thing is the eyes. His eyes go from player to player, sometimes without moving his head. He's generally emotionless, other than to smile or just look at someone in an encouraging way. There's clearly an obvious trust in his players. So let's have a look at Adrian Bolt doing a little bit of conducting with some solo players in a section from Holst's The Perfect Fool. And what I think is amazing about that is the fact that he has that relationship with the players, very simple. And then at the moment of that final chord, there's a whiplash downbeat. It's classic conducting of an era. The next conductor is probably one of the most famous conductors who've ever lived, Herbert von Karajan. And here we have a totally different approach. This hasn't got the sort of communication and leadership that is shown by Bolt. Here we see Karajan, head down, not engaging with the players. His eyes are almost constantly closed, and there's no apparent humor or communication. Now, Karajan claimed that by putting himself into his own world, He removed any danger of being distracted by the movements of players, whether someone's mopping their brow or turning a page, but rather all the music goes through his ears into his brain, and then he can react with lightning precision to correct anything that he doesn't feel is right or going in the way he wants it to. Let's look at the clip, and then I will add something else to carry on. So. So I don't know if everyone had the same experience. Unfortunately, my image and music slightly got out of synchronization, but I hope that you can see that those eyes are down and there's not a lot going on. Now, of course, again, the rehearsal process would have told the players very much what he wanted. But it's interesting that when he joined the Berlin Philharmonic and took over the music directorship there, he wasn't universally liked. And there is a story about when his predecessor, who was loved, a conductor called Furtwängler, slipped into the back of the auditorium once to listen to one of Karajan's rehearsals. Of course, Karajan had his back to the auditorium, so didn't know he was in, but the orchestra did. And apparently immediately the sound changed. Such is the connection between a conductor who's loved by his orchestra and those players. Beethoven's Fifth is notorious. It can be a conductor's graveyard. And I was on a gig once, one of those outdoor summer concerts, very, very fine conductor for musical theatre, unexpectedly was given the first movement of that symphony to conduct, the very moment you just heard. And he waved his arms around, and eventually he had to give up and turn to the leader and say, "What do I do? What do I do?" The final example we're going to see is Valery Gergiev, formerly the London Symphony Orchestra's principal conductor. Now, what you're going to see is someone who looks as though he's holding a toothpick rather than a baton. There's no discernible clarity about what time he's beating, and it's very hard to gauge. I've worked with Gergiev quite a lot, and when I saw this particular clip, I was grateful I wasn't there. We'll play it, and then I'll give you some impressions about it. I know we had a few problems with the synchronization earlier, but don't adjust your set, because what you saw is what he's doing, and that's not a lot. I thought it would be worth me phoning up my colleague, Sam Walton, who's a percussionist in the London Symphony Orchestra, featured there on the snare drum, and to get his impressions about that particular film, which was made about 10 years ago. And Sam very kindly helped me out and started by telling me that that was taken the day that the LSO arrived back in the country from a foreign tour. So they arrived in the morning, they went straight to the Barbican and did that concert. So Sam's usual drumsticks were still in a truck somewhere in Europe. So he found the only spare pair they had, and that's why he got the stripy ones. He's convinced that Gergiev's style is utterly deliberate. He thinks that the minimal, unclear movement is designed to draw you right in. So you really close in on Gergiev's eyes and actions. That's the way he's going to lead you. He does it to the extent that you then become responsible and you have to take control of your own actions. You never feel safe. I know, having played with him, you never relax, never. But if everybody's feeling the same, then it engenders the same thought process as performing intimate chamber music. And that's not unusual to hear, because I've heard a lot of conductors who believe that doing the most they can to encourage players to listen to each other more will engender a greater ensemble. They often refer to huge symphonies as just being a large piece of chamber music. Incidentally, Sam also says that he thinks Gergiev deliberately doesn't give him the upbeat. You'll notice he just raised his eyes and dropped his eyes. And he thinks he does that as to create a little bit of mystery and theatre for the audience. You know, how did the drummer know to play? Another reminiscence here is that the conductor of English National Opera in the 70s, a gentleman called Reginald Goodall, had an equally mysterious beat, I believe. And he came onto the podium to start one of the epic Wagner operas, Parsifal. And after about 30 seconds, nothing had happened. And he leaned down to the principal cello and said, "I have started." So those three styles, I think, really show the leadership within an orchestra can change in any way. And you have to be prepared for anything. And remember that in Bolero that we just heard, when the flute player comes in, I mean, I've played that piece many times and I can count on the finger of one finger the times that the tempo doesn't change when the flute player starts. It's constantly shifting. You've got to have trust, and you hope that you've got trust from the conductor as well. Of course, musicians don't play just in orchestras. We talked about chamber music, and Lydia said I was going to refer to some jazz. So I just thought I'd give you three more examples of the way that musicians have to combine their ideas and using their ears and their feelings to determine who's leading. During these clips, I'd like you to focus, if you can, on the drummer and the bass player, because they are the engine of the bands, and it's the way they approach that gives it a different feel. In fact, Lydia, you came up with an amazing expression the other day, and I've forgotten what it was. It was something about...
Oh, the fighting over the territory that doesn't really exist.
Exactly.
Yeah, it was a bass player and a drummer, both trying to get as far away from just before the beat. And they were sort of wobbling over it, but it didn't exist, but they were still trying to each own it.
So the first, I think that these three clips hopefully examine that. The first clip is probably the greatest jazz and big band drummer of all time, Buddy Rich, an amazing technician and musician, but he was renowned for being a really strict disciplinarian with his musicians. And I think that desire to drive and push people emanated from his drumming style. So we'll just listen to the first few bars of a number called Big Swing Face, and you'll hear that there is no doubt that Buddy is driving his band from the front. So it's right there. Now, I'd like to contrast that with a drummer called Elvin Jones, who's playing here with the Gil Evans Orchestra. Similar sized band, and although it's different music, it has the same straight ahead swing feel, except here, Elvin Jones takes it to another level of drive by constantly interjecting and nudging the players forward. He's leading them. It's his way or the highway, basically. There's constant some musical punches in the ribs of the other players. Let's have a listen. So a completely different approach, but, you know, similar feel. Then the final clip is something which I think is complete antithesis to those. So we're going to hear from the Quincy Jones Band and focus here on the bass player Ray Brown and the drummer Grady Tate, who sit right back on the beat. By which I mean there's no pushing, there's no jabbing, there's no punching. They're just in complete harmony, and I think it really swings. Let's hear that one. The point of each of these clips is that the rhythm section is creating a kind of illusion. So Buddy is pushing, he's leading from the front, but the beat's still in the same place. And yet Elvin Jones is constantly jabbing, punching. It's like a boxing match on the other players, but the beat is in the same place. And Ray Brown and Grady Tate are so laid back, they might as well be falling over, but the beat is in the same place. So I think it's an extraordinary illustration of how you can lead as within a teamwork situation in so many different ways, that the input can come in different ways but still achieve the same result. To go back to orchestral playing, in the UK, the job of the concertmaster, that's the principal first violin, is known, probably not by accident, as the leader. It's a weird job because you have to not only be a violinist of sort of concerto soloist standard, but you have to have a huge range of capabilities, man management, diplomacy, and PR. But in the heat of a concert, it's to him, the leader, that you go when things start going wrong. It's no coincidence that the orchestra is laid out in the way that it is on the stage, so that most of the other players in the orchestra, certainly the principal players, can communicate with the eyes of the leader. I can give you an example of this. A few years ago, I was doing a concert at the Royal Festival Hall of a huge scale cantata by Prokofiev. There must have been 120 players plus a chorus. And unfortunately, the conductor was completely out of his depth. And at a key moment, everything started to unravel. And at that point, the principal trumpet looked over his shoulder to me, because he knew I had a really driving rhythm coming that supported his melody. He looked at the leader, who caught his eye, and they looked at the first trombone. And between us, a sort of combination of strength of character, trust in each other, and quite a lot of self-preservation, we set off on our own. And the rest of the orchestra came with us. And luckily, the ship was righted before completely disintegrating onto the musical rocks. And you've got to, there are times when that you just have to take over to avoid the car crash. There's a great story of an American conductor conducting Daphnis and Chloe, which towards the end of the piece has a section in 5-4. So it's five beats, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. And it was a catastrophe in the rehearsal. And he looked to the orchestra and said, look, none of you look until we get to the last 24 bars, and then we'll be together and we're home and dry. But you can play this by yourself. And they got to that section. And unfortunately, it was the catastrophe they'd hoped they'd avoid. It was on the verge of falling apart until somebody took the lead and drove them home through the last few bars. And the final chord hit, the conductor threw his baton down on the stand and looked at all the orchestra and shouted at them, "One of you mother looked. You can't win." Now, etiquette usually means that the moaning about a conductor's incompetence stays in-house. It's very unusual to hang the dirty washing out in public. The problem is that means that those sort of conductors get to beat another day. Now, the final thing, there's two final things in this to this question. I know it's a long answer, but it is the core of the whole thing. There are times when it doesn't work and the relations break down, and this can work both ways. Firstly, there's the sort of petulant conductor. And I've seen this lots of times when a maestro, in inverted commas, arrives thinking he's above it all. Nothing's good enough, the plane was late, the car's not good enough, the hotel's, whatever. And then he stands in front of the orchestra and it's clear within seconds that he doesn't want to be there. And the feeling quickly becomes mutual. And this is a delicate moment because this is where things can go two ways. Now, if you've got good administrators, and they're worth their salt, they show the initiative, they show some leadership, they step in, they smooth the way, and possibly they have to massage the ego of the conductor, but they get him onto the podium. And then a whole new level of musical diplomacy has to be engaged. The orchestra leader smooths over what remaining cracks there are, and then the key players around the orchestra will marshal their troops in their sections to make sure that the conductor and the orchestra get onto the same page, and that normal service can resume. And you therefore don't resort to the other alternative. Now, the other alternative is an extraordinary thing to experience. And it's when an orchestra decides it's not going to do, or rather it is going to do what it wants, but in spite of the conductor. And it's slightly different to what kicks in to save the concert when a wrecker is conducting. Because in this case, the trust, respect, and desire to collaborate has completely gone out of the window. Rehearsals become noisy, chaotic, ultimately pointless, and often result in arguments. There's a famous story of a Mexican conductor with one of the big London orchestras who were in this kind of mood. He didn't have great English, but in a moment of fury, he did the baton slamming and said, "You think I know fuck nothing? I tell you, I know fuck all." So he got no respect, obviously. Performances then become a mere bash through of the notes. So you get from the beginning to end as quickly as possible and preserve the reputation of the orchestra. This is a really weird thing because it's a deliberate collaborative leadership that in its way is the ultimate in teamwork. That orchestra has decided that what the conductor, he or she is trying to do is wrong, and they won't go with it. And so they completely undermine the person of authority, but deliver a fantastic end product. And orchestras can be very naughty, and they don't respond well when they're being pushed around. There was a case in Scandinavia a few years ago when they had a situation like this. The conductor came onto the platform, put down the downbeat, nobody played, they refused to play. And apparently the look of terror on his face and realization was something to behold. Terror because his actions in being a pain in the bum and all that sort of thing had got to the point that he'd lost any respect. And he realized that because he wasn't making any sound, that behavior meant that he wasn't creating what he'd intended to create. And there's one more kind of leadership within this orchestral section, and that is, we've touched on, but I'd like to expand briefly. I've got two short excerpts to play you, both from the beginning of Mahler's Fifth Symphony, and both featuring trumpeters. I'd like you all to now imagine that you are the trumpeter. And as you listen to this, see how you'd feel seated on the stage in front of a couple of thousand expectant audience members, in the middle of all your colleagues and in front of one of the most demanding conductors of the 20th century, George Scholte. And by coincidence in this occasion in front of TV cameras for broadcast that will be scrutinised for decades to come, including tonight. So let's hear this opening few bars. So that was an American orchestra, but I contacted the Philharmonia Orchestra's principal trumpeter, Jason Evans, a phenomenal player, to ask him about the experience of doing this and what it's like, because obviously there is another dimension here about who's leading who. And to paraphrase what he said, all you've got to do is something that you've done for years and years in practice, and that's to play some fairly simple notes in the right order in tune. It's just on this occasion, there's an extra burden. And that's because the way you play will set the tone for the movement and possibly the whole concert. Get it right and you're a hero. The rest of the orchestra, as he put it, will jump on the roller coaster you started. You started, not the conductor. And then, as he said, game on. So this is where you take the responsibility on your own shoulders to lead from the front using your technical ability, your experience, and frankly, in that case, quite large kahunas. I agree with Jason when he says it's moments like that that mold you as a player. And if you can take that responsibility and deliver it, it marks you out as having the right stuff. And that confidence is a huge factor in any musician's armory. And I'd say confidence is a huge factor for anybody. But he went on to add that arriving at that point is only possible because of the trust and collaboration of your colleagues, including the conductor. And he's always humbled when he hears other people delivering in a similar way. Now, one of the rewards of being able to do that is to get a few more minutes in the limelight. And this is Jason. The next clip is Jason himself playing guest principal trumpet with the London Symphony Orchestra in a moment from the same piece about 6 or 7 minutes later. I asked Jason what it feels like to be playing music like that in an orchestra like the LSO, and he gave me what I thought was an amazing answer, and I think is the prize for being a team player, a leader, a follower. And he said it feels like riding lightning.
Okay, well, Mick, I think I'm going to just ask one more question. I think maybe some of the other things we were going to think about might come up in the discussion, because in a way, this is maybe the other side of some of what you've been talking about. So we've talked about in our discussions about some of the things that can go wrong and be painful in organizational life in an orchestra, and I think I suppose there's something about the possibility for misuse of power, abuse of power, in a situation where people are really exposed and where it's very easy to sort of be, you know, to go beyond critique and into something that's more like bullying. So I wondered if you could just say a little bit about some of your thoughts about that, and then we'll move on. I'm sure some of the other things will come into the discussion.
Yeah. Well, there's a danger here because I don't want the whole conversation to revolve around the relationship between conductors and musicians. But you can't escape that over the years, certain conductors have abused the power they've gained. Now, I've got one clip. Have we got time for this little clip? So this is of a legendary Italian conductor, Arturo Toscanini. And when it was recorded in the 1940s, I think, he was unusually a household name with an international reputation before the jet set had kicked off. He had a reputation for being a fiery character. I think you'll see why.
Hey, contrabassi, follow me! E corte note, short note. So, sembrano dei carri. Non so mica questo meglio. Come Madonna Santissima. Con un Dio, contrabbassi, corri, rompi coglioni, lei. Obviously, you have no ears, no eyes. Corpo d'un Dio Santissimo. You. The first bass, you are always late. You have no ears, no eyes, nothing at all. Corpo d'un Dio Santissimo. But what you believe to be, you? God? No. Testa d'asino. You are not a musician, you are not a ear. Ears, you are not ears, you.
And it goes on for several minutes. Now, a verbal assault like that at the moment, in current times, is virtually impossible. I think everyone's grown up a bit, to be honest. But it's not completely eradicated. And sometimes bullying can be far more subtle because it does happen. The best way I can talk about this is to talk about personal experience. Many years ago, I was taking part in an opera and there was an unfortunate change of events over a few hours, starting with a sleepless night with one of my children and ending with the failure of the equipment to be delivered in the right place at the right time. And that led to me leading my section in a state of severe sleep deprivation and, quite frankly, embarrassment. And unfortunately, I didn't play very well. I didn't deliver. I wasn't doing what I was booked to do. The first indication I got that things were wrong was when I was told by the conductor that there would be no shame if I chose an easier part to play. And although this was done in private, I felt very humiliated and angry. And then the next rehearsal came and went without incident. But the third one was what we call a roast up. And the person being roasted was me. It got to the point that by the coffee break, I was about to walk out and resign. What was the point of working for this person under these circumstances? How was I ever going to deliver when there was such a vindictive approach coming to me? It was very subtle, but at that moment, my co-principal, I suppose in another walk of life you call him my number two, stepped up to the plate with amazing support. And showed real internal leadership, actually, and provided, gave me a little pep talk and also a shoulder to cry on, almost literally. It was timely, generous, and it showed his maturity and experience kicking in just when it was needed. So I didn't resign. But the pressure didn't ease, it got worse. I resorted to taking beta blockers, something that I know a lot of musicians use, but I'd never understood why. They didn't really work. Every performance was utter agony. I hated it. The person concerned knew that a look or a gesture would fill me with uncertainty and nerves. And the strange thing is that nerves can be a good thing, but not in those sort of circumstances because I couldn't harness them. I was a slave to them, really. And I spent a long time after all this blaming myself for poor preparation, a lack of inner steel and a failure to keep things in proportion. But eventually, finally, I realized that what had happened was bullying. It was an abuse of power in a very personal way that up to that point in my career, I'd either been lucky to avoid or I'd been impervious to. Of course, I knew things like that went on. I'd seen it. But to be the object of it was soul destroying, and it stays with you forever. Now, listen, playing musicians aren't innocent of this either. You know, I've seen plenty of examples where people use their position to further their own careers, hold back others, compromise people financially or sexually. And we've seen a lot of cases in the last few years of music teachers being exposed for abusing their positions of power. And some high profile conductors have slipped right out of the limelight after allegations of sexual abuse. So how do you sort it out? If you're going to put so much power in one person's hand, the conductor on the podium, there is always a danger it can be abused. It used to be quite straightforward in old days. There's a percussionist who was dealing with, was playing for Antal Dorati, and he didn't have much to play, and he was reading the paper, and then he noticed there'd been no music for about 5 minutes. And he sort of tuned in and realized that Dorati was absolutely going for one of the French horns. And this guy was an ex-commando. He'd been a commando in the war, just folded his newspaper up and walked straight through the orchestra. He didn't walk around the edge, walked straight through the violins, went up to the conductor, who stopped, obviously. He whispered in his ear and no one knew what he'd said. And then walked back down, picked up his newspaper. Dorati went ashen white. And it was only a few weeks later they found out that he said that if you don't leave my French horn playing friend alone, I'll kill you with my bare hands. Now, luckily, we don't have to resort to that anymore. The discrete processes that we have are so welcome, but you still can't help worry that the person suffering the abuse or bullying is often the one whose voice is least heard.
I think what that also speaks to, Mick, and it's come up in other conversations, is the sort of the level of passion, and you know that the emotions are felt very deeply. And of course, we know that that's true in all sorts of organisations, but actually, in a way, you're talking about something that's really very close to the surface. And maybe there's something about this sort of intimacy of music making and all of that.
Yeah.
I think we probably now need to hear your piece because we were each going to choose one to.
Oh, yeah.
And then I'll leave it. Yeah.
Can I explain why? Well, I chose this because I think it absolutely epitomizes all the things I was talking about leadership, who's in charge, who's following. Teamwork, ensemble, listening, everything. And it's the Count Basie Orchestra playing a tune called All of Me. And the beauty of this, we found a recording where you can see the band as well. It's just everything is together.
thanks, Mick, and thanks to Lydia for a fascinating presentation and discussion. And I'd like us to really show our appreciation right now for a really entertaining and thought-provoking evening. And then I'm going to open it up for discussion and sharing reflections. So thank you very much, Mick and Lydia. And what we'll do is, if you would like to contribute, if you use the raise hand function, I'll invite you in, and obviously the chat will be turned on by Mike and you can contribute there. We would like it to be a space where you can share some reflections and thoughts rather than a question and answer session with Mick and Lydia, and I'll invite them to comment at the end. So open for comments, and the first person I can see is Jenny. Oops, just disappeared now. Who'd like to comment?
I can see one hand up, Helen.
Can you? I can't see a hand.
It's actually me, sorry. I thought if nobody else is going to speak, I'd say something. So I've, in the past, played in a variety of sort of semi-incompetent indie rock type bands in the past, and similarly situations where you're kind of all playing together and moving faster and slower when it all locks in, it feels pretty extraordinary. But I've definitely been in situations as well where you felt you've been in time, and the rest of the band doesn't think you're in time, but you can't understand why you're not in time. And it's sort of one of the most extraordinary, isolating experiences, being in a room with a few different people and everybody else has a different understanding of what's going on. It's sort of a really, suddenly that kind of organization forming around you and you being on the outside of it, sort of, and not having any of the tools or the understanding to kind of get back inside of it. It's sort of a really interesting phenomenon that I don't think I've encountered elsewhere particularly.
Can I just add something to that?
Please do, and then I'm going to invite Adele.
It's interesting because there are all sorts of different time. To somewhere I teach about time. So there's symphonic time where everything's fairly in order. There's jazz time that we talked about, but there's also opera and ballet time where you have to be really flexible to allow for people to ballet dancers to land in the right place. And there's rock and roll time, which is quite often pretty much down there, but will vary. So, time, a friend of mine once said, time is of the essence. There are different kinds of time in music.
Thank you. And Adele Faller.
Yeah, hi. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. I was just sort of thinking about, you just mentioned ballet, and how difficult it is for the conductor then to sort of, he's following the dancers in a way, and having to kind of be the middle person. And quite often a conductor will not have had a rehearsal with the dancers before the dress rehearsal. So he's in a very, very difficult position of having to follow the dancers, which are often sort of, the timing's different, certain parts are much slower, whilst also keeping his orchestra together. And it just made me think what a difficult position the conductor's then put in, really, and for the orchestra as well, because the dancers can't see the orchestra. So in a way, they're kind of, the conductor's having to follow their lead.
Thanks, Adele. And I saw Scott had his hand up. Scott, would you like to comment? Mute, I think.
Helen, I can see Alexandra has her hand up as well.
Yeah, I'm just trying to see if Scott can unmute. Let's invite Alexandra. I can't unmute Scott. The joys of Zoom. Sorry, Scott, we'll try and sort that out for you. But Alexandra, would you like to come on in and comment?
Okay. Really fantastic talk. Thank you both very much. I was really interested in this the tyranny that that seems to run rife through the musician's world. I'm an ex-dancer of many years ago, and I remember that same style, that tyrannical style, was very much part of what I grew up with. You know, a ballet mistress with she used to beat the time with a stick, and there was always the threat that she was going to hit you with it if you didn't perform properly in class. And then this business with the conductors, which I find particularly perplexing, because it seems to me that they are in a way the most vulnerable person in the orchestra, because they're not playing. So the fact that they've got the cheek to then behave as badly as they sometimes do is very interesting. And I'm just fascinated by how it's allowed, how that behaviour is allowed in the arts to continue. And as you were saying, Mick, you know, that there's this business of it's kept quiet, so that because somehow there's a code that says you don't, as you said, wash your dirty linen in public. Well, those people really ought to be outed. But it's interesting that the cultures, certainly I know in dance it's true, I think it's true in theatre too, but that, you know, people just are allowed to carry on, and it's almost as though they're given extra license because of their brilliance, when quite clearly they often aren't brilliant at all. But it's I just find it interesting how that perpetuates, as it does in organisations too, tyrannical leaders.
Can I do something I don't often do, and that's leap to the defence of a conductor?
Please do, Mick.
Because I hope I haven't portrayed some of the things I was saying that it's always like that. Most of the time now, certainly compared to when I started out, the collaborative side of things is much, much stronger. The autocrats, there aren't so many. So I think it's really important to, and I hope it's the same in dance as you've just been referring to.
Yeah, I'm sure that's
Thank
true.
Thank you. Thanks, Alexandra.
I think what you're saying, Alexandra, about organisations is, I think there's something very, there's such a lot that goes on behind the scenes that we don't see.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, in a way, the sort of visibility of the conductor and the orchestra is a very particular thing.
Mm-hmm.
As you say, in organisations as a whole, there can be all sorts of strains on leaders that mean that they can appear to be behaving in a tyrannical way, but there might be much more complicated things going on at the same time. I mean, I was really struck just over and over again, and what Mick was talking about was how intensive that collaboration between conductors and players can be, you know, even from the hornpipe on, you know, that it's such a partnership when it works.
Yeah.
Thanks, Lydia. And Perrine Moran, would you like to unmute?
Yeah. Hi there. I'm going to ask a question on behalf of Maureen and myself. I'm impressed by the intensity, so I've got a question about boundaries. At what point does practice and dedication become a pathology?
That's a great question, and I'm going to ask Lydia and Mick to comment at the end rather than this become a question and answer thing, but we'll hold on to that question. And I'm going to invite Graham to comment now. But please keep talking in the chat as well.
Yes, Lydia, thank you. I'm still trying to recover from the intensity of your introduction. There was so much in it. I'm going to have to listen to a recording. That was a very powerful introduction. Mick, I've known for many years and continue to be amazed at his depth and subtlety. And what he's reminded me of today, I've grown up with a love of music and had music around me and my family in different ways. I've worked for British companies, so English companies, Scottish companies, Spanish companies, and American companies. And I thought I was a pretty good read of judge and judge of character. but Mick has now reminded me of one particular boss who came to the UK for 2 years, and I now realize that he was a complete bully. I worked not just 5 days a week, sometimes 7 days a week. I had a pregnant wife who, on the birth of our first child, he would not give me paternity leave for. He wouldn't allow me to fly to my brother's wedding. And when it came to my end of year performance appraisal, he said, Graham, I think your work's pretty good, but what you've got to understand is when the chief executive comes over from America and you're wearing one of your nice snazzy blue shirts, he's going to think you're an admin person and not front office. And it took me 2 years to work out how this guy operated, by which time he'd left and gone back to the US.
Thanks, Graham. And Judith. Unmute.
Hi. Well, that was absolutely fascinating. Thank you so much. I just have some thoughts around women leaders and women conductors, and whether, I mean, I'd be interested in asking the question about whether there were any differences that you've discerned, Mick, from playing with women conductors. And it's sparked thoughts for me around playing in small jazz ensembles where sometimes the membership matters hugely in terms of building up trust and building up the a way in which it's possible then to improvise and to sort of step out of something that's very predictable and ordered. And that degree of trust depends so much on who's in the band, who's playing with you.
Well, I totally agree about the element of trust, and hopefully that's come out during the evening, that, you know, the collaborative thing within musicians and between conductors, there has to be trust. You have to trust that the person is competent, good enough a musician to be able to deliver. And I think that absolutely ties in with what you're saying about women conductors. There are more and more on the scene now, which is really refreshing. But, you know, when they stand in front of an orchestra, they don't get judged on really what they, well, they shouldn't. And I think largely they don't get judged on what they look like, but what they sound like. What sound they get from the orchestra, because that's what ultimately anybody cares about in that environment. They want to deliver the best possible performance. And if it's a man or a woman, if they bring the right stuff to the party, I don't think anyone thinks twice. The disadvantage is that there's been a history of domination by male conductors, and that's going to be hard to break down, but it is happening. We've seen a few people around the world getting key jobs for the first time, orchestras employing women as principal conductors. And that will only help accelerate the process. So I think ultimately it boils down to how good you are, but I think people are now starting to realize that it doesn't matter what you look like.
I was just thinking, sorry, just to jump in, I was just thinking it's complicated, isn't it? Because if what you sound like is the sound that you can draw from the orchestra, and if you were, as you're saying, moving from a time when maybe 10, 15 years ago, the orchestra might have had a different relationship to what they felt about seeing a woman in front of them conducting, the capacity to draw something, you know, from the orchestra that's going to sound good might be easier now than it was 15 years ago for women, possibly.
Yeah. I mean, the more women who are playing in orchestras and chamber groups and things like that, the more that will develop. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, it shouldn't matter.
Well, I wonder, I don't see any other hands up. I wonder whether you had a view on the question that was asked on behalf of Perrine on when does practicing become a pathology? I think it was the question. Correct me if I'm wrong.
I think it's a really interesting question, and I partly think, you know, lots of things that people do, you know, a lot of and to a very, very sort of persistent standard and are very sort of preoccupied with, might, depending on how one recognizes it for oneself, might have a defensive function. They might have a way of making the world more manageable. And at the same time, they might be in the service of doing something fantastic, like collaborating with other people to create a piece of music. So, I mean, my thought would be, coming from a sort of child psychotherapy side of things, that would be that, you know, there may be things about practicing, learning to play, you know, really being very driven in that direction, that could leave one not in a sort of pathological state, but in a state that isn't really developmental or healthy. But at the same time, I think if it's in the interest, my view would be, if it's in the interest of working with other people and doing something as a whole, that would be one of the things that would temper that. But I'm speaking, you know, I'm not a professional musician. I'm talking more in a sort of as a developmental, with a developmental eye. I mean, I sometimes wonder about the sort of the very, very high pressure on very, very young musicians. And I mean, sort of children and adolescents and things like the National Children's Orchestra, you know, the National Youth Orchestra, the National Children's Orchestra, that sometimes feels as if it's missing something about the kind of messiness of being a child and learning to play and being a young person and learning to play an instrument, that sort of puts virtuosity a bit more at the center than something else. But Mick might have a very different view.
Well, I don't want to talk about things I don't know or understand, but what is becoming obvious and evident is that people are starting to find out that a lot of musicians, I have no idea about percentages, will register perhaps as ADHD, or there'll be an element of autism. And so the idea of being able to focus on one thing repeatedly is not such a big deal, because they've discovered the thing that floats their boat and they're engaged. So that's one aspect to it that I think is fascinating. And that world is opening up. People are looking into that more and more, not only from the performance perspective, but how that can affect people who need to express themselves and haven't found that route.
Thank you. And I'm going to ask you something and then invite you both to say, to make some final comments, as we've got a couple minutes before. But in the three jazz pieces that you showed us, that where they were all on the beat, but in a different, from a different position, I'm really curious about that and the analogies with leadership, that you can get organisations to the same place, but from very different methods of leading. And I just wanted to ask you, in a quite lighthearted way, really, which one did you prefer? And then make any final comments, Mick.
Which one did I prefer? Well, do you know why that's really hard? Because all the players that we heard, I admire hugely. But I think the one that I can listen to over and over again is the Quincy Jones, where it's really laid back, or so it seems. As I say, it's all smoke and mirrors, but yeah, that sort of feel. And the strange thing is, very briefly, that I met those two guys about 10 years ago or so, standing outside the stage door of the Royal Festival Hall. The bass player and the drummer, they were doing a gig. They don't often work together. I got talking to Grady Tate. He was such an amazing bloke. And Ray Brown, who used to be Mr. Ella Fitzgerald and all that sort of thing. We stood outside the festival hall for about 20 minutes talking. And you know, all they wanted to talk about was the fact that I had been working with the London Symphony Orchestra doing some work with Pierre Boulez. And all I wanted to talk about was, how did you get that swing in that tune, you know? So,
Any final comments? We're 1 minute before nine, but Lydia and Mick, anything finally you'd like to say before we show thanks to you again?
Go ahead, Mick.
Well, obviously, I just want to say thank you. I really appreciate being asked. Lydia and I were at the Academy together, so we haven't seen each other for years. But I really appreciate the opportunity to think about and talk about stuff that I deal with every day, but to not be talking to necessarily the students I deal with, but to people who have a very different perspective. And I spoke too long, and I'd love to have been able to talk more in discussion, but thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you. Lydia?
Well, just yes, no, there's so much more to talk about. One of the things we didn't talk about was the sort of kind of music and society and the things that musicians are out there doing to kind of create social value, and you know, that's a whole nother conversation to have, and thank you, Mick, very much for responding after I heard you on the radio and saying, do you want to come and talk about leadership and followership? Thank you.
Pleasure.
Well, thank you all, and let's show our appreciation, and perhaps that's the next meeting, Lydia. Let's say thank you very much to both of you for an amazing evening, and we'll close the session now.